Hello everyone. Welcome to week four, our final week of our advanced webinar series, Creating and Using NDVI from Satellite Imagery. My name is Amber McCollum and I will be your instructor today. Can you all just let me know if you can hear me okay by typing into the chat? All right. Seeing some yeses, so thank you all for that. This is our last webinar for the series. So as a reminder, if you're interested in the certificate of completion, you must have attended all four live webinars and complete all the homework assignments. The week two homework is due today, and the week four homework will be due in 2 weeks on March 16th. When you submit your homework via Google Forms, you will see a thank you for your submission pop up within the browser, but you will not receive an email confirmation. Those will be sent after the final deadline, March 16th, and those will also include the answer keys for the homeworks that you've completed. And those will be sent only to the folks who have completed the homework assignments. The certificates will then be distributed about 2 months from now, so around mid-May, and you will receive that from Marinette Martins. As we've mentioned previously, you can access all the course materials here. Each week, you'll be able to find a PDF of the PowerPoint presentation in both English and Spanish, any data necessary, and the PDF of each week's in-class exercise, a link to view the recording of each week's webinar, and the link to the Google form for the homework submission. Please note that in order to view the webinar recordings, you must register. This will help us keep track of who is viewing the recordings. Once you register, you will automatically be taken to view the recording. On this week's agenda, we will have MODIS NDVI anomaly mapping. Last week, we reviewed the MODIS data characteristics and gave you a few places where you can obtain MODIS data products. We also introduced the EVI and outlined some of the important differences between the EVI and the NDVI. Cindy then demonstrated two useful MODIS NDVI and NDVI anomaly websites. During the first demonstration, she reviewed how to obtain MODIS NDVI data and how to generate simple graphics using the global 16-day 250-meter NDVI time series database. With the second demonstration, we reviewed NDVI anomalies and compared anomalies for specific years to the long-term average. She also showed you how to download the MODIS NDVI.tiff and .csv files. Today, we'll be providing you with a bit for information on some additional Landsat indices that you may want to use for your work. They can be calculated in much the same manner as the indices we have already presented. We will then review NDVI anomalies and what they represent. We will also provide a reminder about the MODIS scaling factor in preparation for our exercise. We will then conduct our final exercise using QGIS, which will take you through some of the steps to create an anomaly map of your own. If there is time, we'll have a short Q&A session. And then we would like to leave a few minutes today for you to complete a short survey that will help us obtain feedback on the usefulness of this course and how we can improve future courses like this. As a quick review before we jump into our exercise, we will discuss a few of these additional spectral indices that you can calculate with Landsat. There are several other spectral indices that have been developed as modifications to the NDVI, which may be useful to you. Last week, we discussed the Enhanced Vegetation Index, or EVI, which corrects for atmospheric influences and also does not saturate at high biomass environments. There is also the vegetation indices, such as the Soil Adjusted Vegetation Index or the Modified Soil Adjusted Vegetation Index, that are useful in areas where vegetation cover is low and the influence of soil brightness is high. The Normalized Difference Moisture Index is a measure of vegetation moisture, and the Normalized Burn Ratio is a measure of burn severity. Next, I will tell you the formulas for each of these so you'll be able to do them yourselves in QGIS or any other geospatial software. In an attempt to improve the NDVI, the Soil Adjusted Vegetation Index, or SAVI, was created. This minimizes the effects of soil brightness, which can decrease the accuracy of the measure of vegetation health, particularly in areas where there is a greater percent of soil exposed. The SAVI uses a soil brightness correction factor to account for these issues. Typically, the value of 0.5 is used. However, you can adjust this depending on your estimated canopy cover. The equation for SAVI is listed here, where L represents the correction factor. As I mentioned, 0.5 is typically used. Calculating the SAVI can be done in the same manner as the NDVI, as we explained in week 2 exercise. Remember the differences in the Landsat bands for Landsats 4, 5, and 7 compared to Landsat 8. This image on the right shows you the SAVI calculated on the same image that we used in our week 2 exercise. You could also do this process and compare this image with your NDVI image to see if you can pinpoint any differences. There's also the Modified Soil Adjusted Vegetation Index, or MSAVI. This index attempts to refine the NDVI in the same manner as the SAVI. However, it is useful particularly when the appropriate soil brightness correct. Factor that L value that we showed previously is not known. Notice that in this equation, the L here is not a variable. That needs to be included. included. This can also be generated using the raster calculator function in QGIS. As the image here on the bottom right shows this calculation. If you're interested in vegetation moisture, you may want to use the normalized difference moisture index. This uses the near infrared and the shortwave infrared bands of Landsat. The shortwave infrared bands highlight the difference between clouds, ice, and snow. Shortwave near infrared light is reflected strongly from plants, and thus is a good indicator of vegetation moisture. If more subtle changes in vegetation moisture can be detected, it's another useful index for drought or for fire. Potential. If the index is low, where vegetation is present, this could mean that the fuel in the area are dry. Which could potentially increase the risk for a while. Wildfire. Generally, the shortwave infrared band 6 is used for land at 8. Remember, there are two. Short wave infrared bands in Landsat 8, band 6 and 7. This figure also gives you an example of what the NDMI image would look like from week 2 exercise. The normalized burn ratio is often used to study disturbance in vegetation caused by wildfires. The equation is the same as the one presented for the NDMI, however, the shortwave infrared band 7 is often used for Landsat 8. This ratio helps to identify where wildfires occurred, as you can see from the red negative values in the region where this fire took place here. While it's useful for an approximation of where the fire occurred, the difference between pre-fire and post-fire condition. Can provide more detail. Information. in general. If you have an image before the fire occurred, and another for short. After the fire. Fire occurred. You can look at the differences and vegetation. From these two. Snapshot. In time. Steps. You would. Would take. To generate the NB. R different map. R first calculate the end. NDR or normalized. burn ratio. For both the pre-fire image and the post fire. Image. Then subtract the value. Values in the post fire image. From the value values in the prefire image. And you can evaluate difference. Identify the wildfire. Boundaries and to take a look. Look at burn. Severity. The high higher the value, in the different map. The more severely the fire. Burned in that region. You can see this is an example here. Of a burn severity map. Can also help in restoration and efforts. That may want to target different regions. Depending on severity of fire. So you can see in these regions. Here there's a more severe burning. Occurred.